considerations for ensembles. It could be any kind of ensemble. This happens to be talking about a drum ensemble. There's a number of aspects inputs to how you play as an ensemble. And one of the things that we find is that a lot of ensembles now are defaulting to the first one up here, which is the player-to-player interaction. So as a new ensemble, we had to confront this. We did not have 100 years of ensemble playing or history within the group to lean on, like some of the groups you're going to hear today. In addition, we had members from all kinds of different cores as part of our core. So we had to make some really conscious decisions about how we decided to play. So the first way input to how you play as an ensemble is how the players play together. And we started out with this. We had some ideas about how the group was going to sound. But we started out with the player-to-player interaction kind of being the driver. You could have a historical context. It could be with the history of the group, as in the Moodus, Drum, and Fife Corps. Or it could be a reenactment group. It could be a Civil War group. So you may want to play the drum a certain way because of that context. It could be the instruments you play. Just looking around the room, there's a bunch of different types of instruments that we have here. Some have rods on them. Some have ropes. Some have Kevlar. Some have calf. And depending on the way that instrument's set up, it's going to cause you to play it in a different manner. As soon as you start to mix those within a group, you get sometimes sub-optimal results. So there are also regional influences, probably less so now than maybe 30 years ago. 30 years ago, you could tell a New York corps from a Connecticut corps very easily. That's not really the case anymore. And it could be the tunes or the arrangements that you play. So what type of music you're playing. And that was kind of the key for us as we began to differentiate ourselves against the groups that we came from, is we were playing a little bit different music from a different period, generally at a different tempo, and with different styles of arrangements than were common. But the main thing is to make a decision for your group that's right for the way you want to play. So if you're playing a very contemporary style, competition style, you should be focused on the style inputs that are appropriate there. So when we thought about that, we thought a lot about what are the inputs to creating a style of your own or getting that ingrained in the group. So the first step is it always starts with the warm-up for us. When we started, we didn't do a warm-up, we just played tunes. And what we found is we didn't play them the same way. We didn't approach them from the same way. We all had different technique. We're all used to different things. We actually all set up our drums a little bit differently. So, of course, we wouldn't have the same technique. And as we started to standardize the technique, different things started happening. The second thing is that the arranging and the coaching that you give must back up the style that you're trying to reinforce. Setting a roadmap is really important. Knowing that you can't get there in one marching season or two marching seasons, that you're going to have to take into account different fluctuations in your schedule. You just may not get there. Knowing that you can't jump to the top of the mountain. It takes time to get people there. And then lastly, identifying outliers. This one's a little bit problematic for some people. You need to identify, if you're coaching an ensemble, who's with you, who gets the style that you're trying to play, who doesn't get it but wants to be there, and then who is really just a resistor to that style. I play this way, this is the way I play, so this is the way I'm going to keep playing. And it's really important that you identify that up front, because it's the cause of a lot of friction in ensembles. And it changes the dynamic in the group. And if you can just put a name to it and say what it is, you can really quickly move past it and say, this might not be the right place for you if you're not willing to change. Not every ensemble is going to ask that of their players. For us, we had to. It was really important because we wanted to play a certain way. Okay? So let's talk a little bit about how we applied some of these concepts. We were formed in 2005. As I said, everyone came from a different core. They were active in different cores. That means they all had different Some things went really well up front. Kind of the fast shoot 'em up stuff was fine. When we started to get to more subtle arrangements, we ran into trouble. And the trouble came because we weren't using a similar technique. Let me just walk you through briefly how we established a technique for our drum group. And this isn't the right or wrong way to play. This was right for us based on those inputs that I talked about, right? Based on the music, the way the drums were set up, based on the tempos. That's right for us. So this may be hard to see, but there's a piece of music here. This is the Frog Song. It was written in 1896. The melody, the drumming was written 2006 or 7, I think. And we had a heck of a time playing this. It was a little bit faster than we were used to. It didn't have the normal type of pickups that we were expecting. And it really flummoxed us for a little while. The drum part was written in a moment of inspiration, and I'll be honest with you, I couldn't play it after that. I had a lot of trouble executing the drum part. If you step close to that, you'll see that there's a bunch of different notations that indicate ghost strokes, medium accents, loud accents. And this became really important because we knew when it sounded right and we knew when it didn't. We put that into the music, but we had trouble executing. So let's just play this, and then we'll talk a little bit about how we got the journey of being able to play this together. So we're going to play just the A, A for us. Stone was talking about in accents and rebounds, and what Moeller was talking about. There were really four technical problems that we had to solve. And when we got them down to the lowest level, they were really being up here, coming back up here, being up here to a full stroke, leaving it down, down to down, down to up. And when we analyzed the drumming, what we found is when we played it well, our hands were in the right place before we play the note, not when we play the note. So I hope that doesn't sound too mystical or weird, but what we found was when we twitched to get accents and struggled to do an upstroke and downstroke really fast, the music jumped. It rushed, had a tight feeling to it. And so a lot of our focus became removing that tightness in the playing. How can we play some of these figures without having that tension? How do we play the 16th notes without them sounding rigid, but having a little bit of float in them, a little bit of swing in them? And how do you play an accent and not pound it, right? Because it didn't ever sound good when we pounded it. So we actually came up with an exercise. It's a very straightforward exercise. You could play the first page of Accents and Rebounds and just be just as good as this. I know it's a little bit of an eye chart. I can provide it to everyone if you want it, but it's a very straightforward sticking pattern. It's the same pattern four times in a row. It's a mix of single and double strokes on each hand. Same pattern. We just move the accent around each time we play it. And what it forces you to do, you start with the standard. The first one is very straightforward. Relaxed accent. And again, the goal is not to squeeze the stick and push it down, but just let it drop from a higher height. The next thing we did was we moved that accent over a beat. And that meant that your hand had to be up before the stroke, and we had to be thinking a couple of beats ahead every time. Again, that was moving it over. The third one, again, you're going to have to go from low to high to low again. And then the third one. So that's really all it is. It was a very simple technical exercise. We made it simple because we wanted to be able to focus on what our hands were doing and where they were. So we're going to play it once slow. We usually play it with repeats in here. We'll play it without the repeats so we don't bore you all to tears. But let's play it once slow. And